In the midnight moonlight, I'll be walking along a lonely mile. And every time I do, I keep seeing this picture of you. Here comes my baby, here she comes now. And then comes
he. As the first person, he was the first person in this world whom I met, and I instantly thought, I want to marry this person, I want to have children with this person, I see this person as my future husband.
I love her with all my heart, of course. I mean, the way that everything played out, it just exemplifies why that even if I have to wait just a little bit, it's all worth it. The wait is worth it.
Here comes my baby. Here she comes now.
Who gives this woman in marriage?
I do.
Is that Malcolm right up here?
Thank you.
David, right here. There you go. Please be seated.
Where's the file?
A marriage is a commitment to life, to be the best that two people can find and bring out in each other. It offers opportunities for sharing and growth that no other human relationship can equal. A joining that is promised for a lifetime within the circle of its love. Marriage encompasses all of life's most important relationships. A wife and a husband are each other's best friend, confidant, lover, teacher, listener, and critic. There may come a time when one partner is heartbroken or ailing, and the love of the other may resemble the tender caring of a parent for a child. Marriage deepens and enriches every facet of life. Happiness is fuller. Memories are fresher, commitment is stronger, even anger is felt more strongly and passes away more quickly. Marriage understands and forgives the mistakes life is unable to avoid. It encompasses and nurtures new life, new experiences, and new ways of expressing love through the seasons of life. When two people pledge to love and care for each other in marriage, they create a spirit unique to themselves, which binds them closer than any spoken or written words. Marriage is a promise, a potential, made in the hearts of two people who love, which takes a lifetime to fulfill. As two trees growing next to each other, one should not tower over the other as to block out the sunlight and stunt its growth, nor should they grow so close as to entangle their roots to suffocate or weaken one another, nor should they grow so far apart as to let something grow between them, depriving each of their individual needs, but to grow side by side. Come on together. Here we go. Leaving each other enough space that each may grow tall and strong and achieve their full potential. Svetlana, will you pass your flowers? Join hands and look into each other's eyes. Do you, David, take Svetlana to be your lawfully wedded wife, promising to love and cherish her through joy and sorrow, sickness and health, and whatever challenges you may face for as long as you both shall live?
I do.
Do you, Svetlana, take David to be your lawfully wedded husband, promising to love and cherish through joy and sorrow, sickness and health, and whatever challenges you may face, for as long as you both shall live?
I do.
David, let this ring be a symbol of your undying love. Place this ring on Svetlana's finger and repeat after me. I, David, take you, Svetlana, to be my wife.
I, David, take you, Svetlana, to be my wife.
My partner in life and my one true love.
My partner in life and my one true love.
I will cherish our union.
I will cherish our union.
And love you more each day than I did the day before.
And love you more each day than I did the day before.
I will trust you and respect you.
I will trust you and respect you.
Laugh with you and cry with you.
Laugh with you and cry with you.
Loving you faithfully through good times and bad.
Loving you faithfully through good times and bad.
Regardless of the obstacles we may face together.
Regardless of the obstacles we may face together.
I give you my hand, my heart, and my love.
I give you my hand, my heart, and my love.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For as long as we both shall live.
For as long as we both shall live.
I, Svetlana, take you, David, to be my husband.
I, Svetlana, take you, David, to be my husband.
My partner in life and my one true love.
My partner in life and my one true love.
I will cherish our union.
I will cherish our union.
And love you more each day than I did the day before.
And love you more each day than I did before.
I will trust you and respect you.
I will trust you and respect you.
Laugh with you and cry with you.
Laugh with you and cry with you.
Loving you faithfully through good times and bad.
Loving you faithfully through good times and bad.
Regardless of the obstacles.
Regardless of the obstacles.
We may face together.
We may face together.
I give you my hand, my heart, and my love.
I give you my hand, my heart, and my love.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For as long as we both shall live.
For as long as we both shall live.
David and Svetlana have just sealed their relationship with the giving and receiving of rings. Matrimony is called holy because this brave and faithful promise of a man and a woman to love and honor and serve each other through thick and thin looks beyond itself to a more faithful promises still and speaks mightily of what human life at its most human and most alive and most holy must be always. Every wedding is a dream, and every word that is spoken there means more than it says, and every gesture, the clasping of hands, the giving of rings, is rich with mystery. And so it's that we hope with every bride and groom that the love that they bear one another and the joy that they take in one another may help them grow in love for the whole world where their final joy lies. Whom God has joined together, let no man tear apart. When their days are done and the sun is setting, may they be found then as they are now, still hand in hand, grateful for the love they have found in each other. You may kiss the bride. I present to you for the first time, Mr. and Mrs. David Townsend!
And you didn't actually, they have found their life, so it's very important to save it. And I believe that you do everything to save it. So thank you for this. Я благодарю за то, что он, ну, я уверена, что они сохранят свою любовь. Я желаю им очень много счастья, очень много любви. Пусть буду счастлива. I love you guys. I love Svetlana very much.
I've been friends with DJ since about 2009. We worked together at Carmax, and I can't speak more than one language. And more than that, the best thing to come out of me is the flower girl. So. But DJ, I don't know why we're friends or press that time. At Keystone Pipeline, I got so mad at you at work and starting to prefer the oil, the used oil and the wetland. You about killed me. But I'm here and I'm at your wedding and I'm proud to be your friend. When you told me about Svetlana, I hadn't seen you that excited in a long time, and I'm glad y'all got married and had it, and I'm glad to be a part of your life. And my brother passed away when I was 17, and I haven't felt this close, you know, as part of family. We come up here during Thanksgiving, and he's lived with me a couple, three times when he kept going over to Europe and coming back and doing whatever he's doing. So I'm glad he's here. So Svetlana, welcome to our country. I'm really excited that you're here and going to be part of everybody. So I hope everyone. That's it.
To give a little story, speech, Svetlana, I don't know if you know the story of when I first heard about you. It's kind of a pivotal story for a lot of reasons. So, I had something that I needed to tell DJ, and he was like, well, I also have something that I really need to tell you too. And I was like, all right, he's like, are you free now? I'm gonna call you. And I was like, all right, I'm in the bath. So I had a phone call in a bathtub with my brother.
Didn't know that part of the story.
No. Now you all do. And it's a very clean story. And so he told me how he met somebody. And for the first time, he saw things as poetry. And for the first time, he felt like he was in love. And my heart was so full to hear my older brother talk in a way that I've always wanted him to talk. Also with a lot of butterflies, because my story was a little bit different. because I was like, I'm so happy you found this woman. I have something to tell you too. I also found a woman. and that was how I told him that I was gay. And he was like, oh. I didn't think a story could top this one. And I think that was a pivotal point for a lot of reasons, because I think we both learned how to love authentically. And we, stage fright and crying are not my strong suits. and thousands of miles away, you brought me and my brother closer. I just want to thank you for this.
And again, I don't know if I can top a story like that. This is ridiculous. It's my wedding and I'm getting topped. It is though. Thank you, everybody, for coming. I mean, delays, weather, everything, distance, lots of distance. Some very local, some not so local, travel delays, everything. People still made it here. Everybody's accounted for. Nobody was turned away. I'm just almost flights shut down, but we brought them here anyways, whether you liked it or not. I'm just so happy that everybody's here. And I mean, I'll give an annotated version of like how I met Svetlana, how it all happened. I was in Geneva. I was an intern at the United Nations. I was very excited, just full of wonderment, because I've never left the U.S. before. I'm
meeting all these foreigners that I've never met before, hearing languages I've never heard before, just blown away. And one of my colleagues at the UN had invited me to come to a party for the first time that I was in Geneva, and I had been just cooped up, hadn't had anything to drink, just been so focused on everything. So I finally, all right, finally I can go online to go meet people, have fun. I had way too much fun. And my first interaction with Alana was where I was at a state of mind that I should not have been in. And I mean, it's my wedding. I made a total ass of myself. And I just remember bits and pieces where she was the first real Russian that just blew me away. Just quintessential Russian. She looked gorgeous. She was taller than me, which just stunning. And I was so drunk. I was just stammering my words. I was the friend that brought me to the party was also Russian, so I was trying to impress her with words that I knew, but I didn't know them, so it sounded horrible. I didn't know English at the time either. So needless to say, it was not a positive interaction, and I was ready to go. So that next week, I just ran into her, and I was super embarrassed, just absolutely mortified. I didn't want to see her again. I just thought, this is a horrible experience. I don't want you to think that all Americans are like this. We already knew what people thought of Americans in Europe, so I didn't want to ruin that. And she was super sweet, and we had a great conversation. Just talking about how sweet I was despite everything. Yeah, I don't remember that, but that's great. So I was just like, oh, this is great. I'm happy to see you again, but I kind of hope never to see you again because I was so embarrassed. So fast forward a few weeks, the friend that had left, or that I had met at the UN and invited me to that party, had since left, and there was a vacancy. And the woman told me that she was coming this day and that we needed to have lunch. We all had lunch together every single day. We all went out in the Palais, we had this great lunch. And so she told me, hey, this new girl's coming, be sure you invite her to have lunch with everybody else. So I'm at the UN, bear in mind, I'm dressed almost as dapper as I was tonight. I was standing outside making copies of something, and here walks in Svetlana to her first day of the job, two offices down from me. I dropped everything I was doing. I told her, we're going to get coffee at some fancy coffee place, and I'm going to show you that, you know, I'm not such an ass, and I'm not always that drunk, and tell you that, you know, tell her about myself and everything like that. So it started, and we went to the cafe, and, you know, for the next 4 months, she was two doors down from me, and she would stay late every single night, because she was actually in Geneva studies, so she was studying in French. So she would just stay late, and after her work, she would work on her studies, work on all of her assignments. So it started with me just kind of poking my head in as I was leaving for the day, saying, why are you still here? You know, you're an unpaid intern, you should be going, this is ridiculous. And she would say, well, this is the palace of Geneva, a little overlooking Lake Geneva, so I'm just doing my work here. So then it turned into me just going and sitting in, and I would ask her about her schoolwork, and then we'd talk about, you know, different cultural differences, and it just blossomed, and then it turned into I would stay there till 8, and then I'll stay there till, you know, 9, and then I'd be like, want to go get a drink, and then I was want to go get dinner, and then before we knew it, you know, we were, something just blossomed that I could have never, ever predicted. Traveling for such a short amount of time in a foreign country, I thought I was just coming in, coming out, continuing my life, but I didn't think that this commitment that I was taking a huge gamble on because it was unpaid, and I was in the middle of my master's program, that I would end up meeting my wife. And I left. When I left, her at the airport in Geneva crying. She was just hysterical. And I just thought I had a really strong summer crush, and I was gonna try to get over it, but as soon as I got on the plane, it was just, she left me this card that I still have, and it's framed. I have it home, that she wrote about her experience that she had with me. And she didn't tell me not to open it until I got on the plane. Oh, on plane, started bawling my eyes out. I called her as soon as I got to New York City, which is the layover, and I told her that somehow, some way, we're gonna meet up, whether it's just in a foreign land, just to meet up and see each other again, or something serious is gonna happen. So I got back, 3 months later, I I fought really hard and I got this opportunity and I went back to Europe. If it wasn't for her, I would have just stayed in the US. Just who knows what I would have ended up doing, but I had to go back to Europe just to be on the same continent. So I got back, and within 6 months of leaving Geneva and coming back and moving to Paris, within 6 months, my first flight out of Paris was to Moscow, and then within 3 days, I proposed to her. So I proposed to her the first trip. After the last time I saw her, she was crying in Moscow. The next time I saw her, she was crying in Geneva. The next time I saw her, she was crying in Moscow, so I proposed to her in her home city. And, you know, and at that point, we didn't know how. This was 3 years ago that I proposed to her. We've been engaged for 3 years, and this is the culmination of that. So we didn't know how. I didn't know understand the legalities of it, and I can tell you, it sucks. It's about 70 pages of applications and trying to make your relationship seem legitimate on paper for legal reasons is very romantic. Right. Scanning passports, scanning postcards, scanning cards we sent each other, just proving that we have a bona fide relationship. So we did it, you know, 7 months later, however much later, we got approved, our visa was approved, she came last month, and now we're here getting married in front of all of our friends and family. Patience, to love, to everybody.
Cheers.
Yeah.